Hi, everyone. This is our weekly podcast, audio video podcast, special guest here in the studio. I should say, by the way of introduction, even though you see it on the screen here, I'm Larry Gordon. And this is our audio video version of the Five Towns Jewish Times. And our guest is a young lady from Brooklyn, New York, soon to be a resident of Eretz Yisrael. Her name is Orly Wahba. I said that right.
You said it correct. I'm very impressed.
Okay. I've watched you a lot online. I followed a few of the things that you've done, which I'm going to ask you about. But the main thrust of your campaign, you've started out as a school teacher in Brooklyn.
Correct.
Right? You're from the Syrian Jewish community?
Exactly.
Okay. So I know a little bit about you.
Okay.
And You were a teacher. You started as a teacher. What school were you a teacher at?
I was a teacher in a yeshiva flatbush. I was teaching 7th and 8th grade, Chumash and Navi.
Okay. And that was until how many years ago?
That was back in the end of 2011. June 2011 is when I left.
Okay, so that's been 9 years almost.
It's crazy,
right?
Yeah.
So what have you been doing since then? What moved you in this new direction?
Well, really, I was initially taking just a year off from teaching. That's all it was going to be. But apparently every big thing that's happened in my life happened because I was only going to take a year doing something.
Okay.
And the idea was to put my all into a dream I had ever since I was a little kid. It was a dream about really bringing people together through the power of kindness. And so a lot of the things that I was teaching within my classroom of kindness, compassion, empathy, my students actually were the ones that gave me the courage to go out there to share that message with the world. So I was going to take a year off to see what happens if I put my all into this dream of mine. And I started a nonprofit organization called Life Vest Inside. And the mission is to inspire, empower, and educate people of all backgrounds to lead a life of kindness. But the essence is really about empowerment and empowering people to recognize their value. And it started with a short film I did back in 2011.
So I'm going to guess that the name of the foundation, Life Vest Inside, was inspired by that film you always see before you take off on a flight.
Actually,
there's a life vest inside your seat in case you need it in an emergency.
Well, it was actually inspired on a plane. That is very, very correct.
Well, that's probably where it came from, that video.
I was on a plane. It wasn't actually a video. You know the signs on the plane that say, they see either life vest under your seat.
Right,
this one happened to say life vest inside. Right. Mm-hmm. I was on a flight with my family. It was back in 2009. And we were going away on winter vacation. It was actually right around this time. Mm-hmm. At the time, there was a young girl in my community, a 6-year-old girl, that was diagnosed with leukemia. Mm-hmm. And as you know, the entire community comes together in tefillah and praying mm-hmm. for this person to feel better. Mm-hmm. I didn't know her personally, but everybody was praying. And as I got off the plane and was switching planes, I heard my voice messages and just got the message that this little girl passed away. And it was very devastating. And that exact moment, the first thing that I thought about was my 7th grade students back at home. Because right before winter vacation, they started opening up to me about something for the very first time. Because a classmate of theirs passed away to the same illness just 3 years prior when they were in 4th grade. And they started asking me really difficult questions. You know, why does Hashem do certain things? Why do bad things happen to good people? And I just started to be able to get through to them, provide to them some sort of a comfort and understanding. And I said to myself, what am I going to do when I get back home? How am I going to be able to explain to them how something yet again so tragic and devastating happened? And to somebody that's so young, you know, how do you find order in this chaotic world and stay afloat, essentially, in a world that seems to be pulling you downward? And I get onto the plane, I had tears in my eyes, and I'm just looking up to Hashem and saying, how do you stay afloat? How do you stay afloat? And I look to my left, the stewardess, I wasn't actually supposed to be in that seat. I was put in a different seat. Mm-hmm. And I look to my left, and right on the wall of the plane was a small little sign, and it said on it, Life Vest Inside. And I looked up, and I smiled, and I said, okay, I understand, Hashem. And the concept and idea is that our life vest, our greatest life vest is inside of us. It's through the kindness that we bestow on others and through the kindness that others bestow on us that we keep each other afloat, because we're never going to be able to prevent the obstacles from coming.
Okay, so let's talk about kindness.
Yeah.
I mean, you did a TED Talk and you become an expert to an extent, I guess.
Expert. I don't know if I would say expert.
Expert
I'm trying
kindness.
Every day. It's something you work on every day.
So explain to me your view of kindness. Is kindness an antidote to everything that plagues the world, do you think?
In my opinion, it's very, very much connected to that. But there's a little bit something deeper than that. See, the biggest issue I feel like that's happening within the world, especially the societal issues that are happening in today's time, is that people have a lack of self-value and self-worth, not recognizing that who they are matters, that they are important, that they have a purpose, that there's something that they're meant to do that nobody else can do. Now, we find this validation from all sorts of external ways that people tell us should validate us, whether it be based on how much money we have, how many friends we have, how popular we are, but these things don't truly fill that sense of purpose. The greatest thing that can validate, that can truly validate a person in the positive way, is an act of kindness. Because when we engage with kindness and when we engage with giving to another, we come to actually see our true value. We didn't have to be anybody else. We didn't have to be the wealthiest guy or the prettiest person or the smartest or the fastest. We needed to just be us. And that's the idea. Kindness is the greatest tool to empower a person to understand that. But if you look at, you know, one of the most basic concepts it talks about, or seems like it's basic, and says, "Ve'ahavta l'recha kamocha," to love your fellow like you love yourself, really doing kindness for others, that's one thing, okay? But living kindness is very, very, very different. The hard part about that is not about doing for others. It's about kamocha, actually loving who you are. If you truly love yourself, if you truly are actually kind to yourself, and most people don't actually understand what does that mean? If we really love who we are, we're able to then love other people for who they are as well. One of the biggest problems is that we don't actually have that true sense of value.
So is kindness part of the natural human condition, or does it take effort? Does it come to people naturally, or does it take effort to do that? And is the natural human condition, you know, theoretically the opposite of that?
I think that kindness is something that we are naturally born with. I think that it is part of the human condition 100%. But just like anything else, it's something that we have to work on. We could sometimes take things for granted. Why are we put into this world? For one reason, is to perfect our character. That's why we're here. And it's a muscle just like any other muscle. If somebody wants to suddenly, they've never ran a day in their life, or they suddenly want to run a marathon the following day or do a triathlon, it's not going to happen overnight. It's something that takes continuous to work on it and to actually increase the muscle. The muscle of kindness is the eyes. This is the muscle of kindness. Opening our eyes to start seeing the opportunities. Because the more that we work at our eye muscle to see the good also in the world, the more good is reflected back at us. And, you know, if we take, for example, if we look at Avraham, right? Isha Chesed, the guy, the man of kindness. He didn't actually do kindness. Kindness isn't something that you do. It's not something you check off of a list. It's done. It's something that you live. It's the way that you see the world, but it begins with the way that you see yourself. And so being able to look around at all times, to be aware of your surroundings, but the greatest way to be able to actually see people and see what's needed is you have to be able to first recognize that you are valuable as well. And then you recognize we're all a piece of the puzzle.
We're talking with Orly Wahba. So what you're saying is, which might be different than what is perhaps part of everyone's daily routine, is that kindness is not exclusively something that benefits the other person, but it also benefits the source of the kindness.
Well, that's always. Anytime that you give, you're actually receiving. But the idea behind kindness is that kindness doesn't just mean, for example, charity work. A lot of people talk about, here, I'll give you an example. In schools, a lot of schools, Jewish schools, non-Jewish schools, non-Jewish schools, they all have hours, right? Kids have to do charity hours.
Chesed hours.
Now, is that, they call it chesed hours.
Right.
So what does that mean? How are we now helping a child understand the concept of chesed, of kindness? That it's something that you have to fulfill a quota on? Yes, going to an old age home and visiting or going to a soup kitchen is definitely a kind thing to do. It's fantastic. I'm not putting that down. But you don't have to actually go anywhere to engage in kindness. How is it that you talk to your family? How do you talk to the security guard when you come into school that morning? How do you talk to the person that's cleaning the office or your house? The guy that's working underneath you? It's not about, oh my goodness, okay, I'm going to take a week off and go on a mission of chesed. I'm going to go and do, that's great. I'm not putting that down. But what that allows us to do is it allows us to separate ourselves from this action, to look at it just as an action, as opposed to, who are we actually? How are we seeing the world? How are we seeing the people? And you can have a person that goes and does a chesed activity, and they can walk out and look up and down, look a person up and down, and make that person feel like garbage. Mm-hmm. So is that person kind? What is kindness considered to be? Is it just an action, or is it a state of being? And that's the idea.
So how does performing acts of kindness, how does that impact on the state of the world?
So on several ways. Number one, it impacts directly on that person. Okay. Yes, of course we feel good, right, because we do kindness. It also impacts on us because we recognize that we actually are a contributor into this world and that we are a giver. Now, it is my belief that the world has everything that we need in order to take care of the various issues that are happening in today's world, whatever those issues may be. But we need to realize that we are all interconnected, that the action that I do here affects somebody over there. So how does it help? Well, if each and every one of us understand that we matter, then we recognize that our choices also matter. Now, this is the key. When a person recognizes that their choices matter, they're more likely to make the right choices. Mm-hmm. Why do people make sometimes a negative choice? Why does somebody choose to write something negative on somebody's page? At the essence of it is because they don't think that their actions really create that much of a ripple. But if we realize how powerful we are as beings, we are powerful beings, we create worlds and we can destroy them also, in just a moment, everything changes. We're more likely to make better choices. Now, if we can empower people to give back into their own communities, into their own areas, the world will take care of itself. But the beginning, the start of that is first to empower a person that they do actually matter and that their choices to do good matter and make a difference.
So you have a remarkable presence on social media. How did that evolve? I mean, it started about, am I guessing, 10 years ago?
Yeah, well, it really started with the Kindness Boomerang video. I shot a short film during my summer off from teaching, a film that went crazy viral. How? I don't know. Honestly, I tested it to Hashem. It went viral because Hashem wanted to go viral. Okay. I didn't do anything. I didn't do any marketing whatsoever, okay? But I put my heart and soul into that video in terms of the messaging, okay? Every moment it was filled with that. It started with a video going up on YouTube. I didn't have a website. I had nothing at the time, nothing. All I was doing for 20 out of the 24 hours a day was responding to YouTube comments. I know that sounds crazy, but that's what I was doing. I didn't have a website. I had no other means of communication. I didn't know what I was doing yet. I was just forming the organization. The video went viral within the first month of me leaving my job.
We're talking about 10 years ago or less?
This is 2011. October 2011 is when the film went online.
So eight plus years ago.
Yeah. And it was just responding to comments and developing relationships with people from every different background, from all different religions, in different languages, hundreds of thousands of comments, and creating these relationships. Then I started recognizing that, and I moved over to, I said, okay, guys, I'm going to start a Facebook page. And I started posting up acts of kindness, you know, every day. And from there, it continued. But really, where it began is developing a relationship, the most basic thing that you can do, responding to another human being. And creating these relationships, allowing people to feel that they're heard. There were sometimes on the YouTube channel fights that would break out, okay? With people that have different beliefs. Oh, this is what, you know, this country believes or this religion believes. And there would be these religious wars that would break out on the page. And I would come in and mediate with kindness, and you would see the shift in the way that people saw each other. It was wild. Simply because you're taking the time and the patience and allowing people to have their voice and recognizing that sometimes we're going to disagree. The objective is not to make everybody agree with you. We're never all going to be agreeing with one another.
So how many people have seen that video to date? Do you have any idea?
The truth is, at this point, it's too difficult to actually keep track of. It's well over 100 million. On our YouTube channel, I think the number is at over 30-something million, and then it's been uploaded to all sorts of other channels where it had hundreds of millions of views. So it's...
Have you done additional videos since then on the same
not
subject?
Not to that same caliber. I've done a few other videos, but mainly it's just, I guess it's a funding thing. But I have scripts that I'm hoping, one of my next scripts I'm actually hoping to film in Israel when I get there. I'm working on getting the rest of the funds for it and then going to create it. And it's called Unity, and it's to do with children, really.
So tell us a little bit about yourself, because obviously you're chock full of these fascinating ideas. So you're born in Brooklyn?
I was born in Brooklyn. I grew up here my whole life from the Sephardic community, as you know. I went to Flatbush as a child. You know, then went back as a teacher, which was the most fantastic, amazing experience. I studied film production and English at Brooklyn mm-hmm. College, and then mm-hmm. Jewish history at Touro College. Mm-hmm. And I was very, very much involved with community activities in terms of getting involved, like in the actual seminars and organizations and charities and running different projects. that really happened starting in my senior year of high school. I was actually a very shy kid growing up, super shy, and went through hardships, as we all do. We all go through hardships, but oftentimes those hardships shape us and help us to become the people that we're meant to be. And for me, that happened at the age of 15.
So I was following you for a while. I think it was on Facebook when you were in Israel for an extended period of time, about a year ago.
Yes. I moved there about a year and a half ago. I was only going to be there for the year. Okay. And then it turned out now that it's going to be, it became a permanent move.
So you went to live there for a year.
Yeah.
Was
the goal.
To work on what? Just to make
Aliyah? I was going to be working on Life Fest Inside, on the organization, as I still do. It has like a leadership training program that I was working on, a school program. So I was still working on that from there. The job that I do allows me and affords me the ability to be wherever it is, as long as I have internet, and to be in Israel. I love the country very much, always have, and felt very connected and very drawn to being there. But there was also a personal reason why I wanted to go there. And that was to change things up and Bezrat Hashem to find my match and to get married.
Okay.
Things weren't happening for me here.
Okay.
And so I said, you know what? Mishanem makom, mishanem mazal. If I move, maybe things are going to change. Shake things up a bit.
Okay.
And that was the purpose.
So you did a project, 40 days at the Kotel.
The 40-day Kotel challenge.
I don't think I saw all 40, but I probably saw 30 of the 40. So what was that like?
I have to tell you, it was an amazing experience. I decided to do this the night before Tu B'Av. And I wasn't sure if I was going to do it or not. I was nervous to do it. And I said, you know what? If I'm going to make it something that I'm going to actually put on video and I'm going to proclaim out to the public of what it is that I'm praying for, perhaps I can inspire others to do the same in their own right. And it's going to allow me, first of all, to be accountable. I love being held accountable to do certain things. And I knew that that was going to be my accountability partner, was going to be these Facebook Lives. And I said, this is a really opportune moment. Tu B'Av is all about,
matches
and shidduchim, exactly. And I knew that it was going to go up until right before Rosh Hashanah, ending on the first day of Briat HaOlam. I said, I have to do this. And I started, throughout the process, it was hard. Every single day, having to click on that Facebook Live and make a video, not knowing what I was going to say. I never prepared what I was going to say. It was just going off of the moment. It was a very scary thing because I had to be able to be vulnerable, to say what it is that I'm asking for and to become really clear about what it is that I'm asking for. And I loved it. It was 3 hours of my day every single day. And the amount of people, the responses that I was getting from people from all over the world reaching out. I have a journal till today with the names of every person that reached out to me to pray for them. I was praying for 500 people by the end. Each and every day. It was wild and exciting.
You must have gotten a bunch of proposals too.
You would think so. It's funny. Somebody asked me.
Didn't get any.
I got to tell you, no, it's really funny. People said, oh, yeah, you're doing this thing. I'm sure you're going on dates all the time now. And then, honestly, that didn't happen. That's the honest truth. That did not happen.
Not one?
During that 40 days?
You were too busy.
Not one. No, that's not true. I'm telling you, I was so open. And I said, I was also worried. I said, I don't want people to think, this isn't a magic trick. It's not like you do this and everything happens. I believe that life is about the planting of the seeds. Okay, and that's exactly what God does. He plants seeds. We don't necessarily, you don't see the fruits grow the next day, but the seeds are being planted. So I wasn't disappointed in the fact that, well, what's going on? Shouldn't something be happening? It was really more of an internal journey than anything, and being able to become clear. And I felt that I did grow tremendously from it. And right after that experience, I met some of my best friends right now. I met them the week after going through this experience, who are very much a part of my journey. And I think that, that's really important, being able to have friends that you care about and that care about you and that are there to help support you through the hardships that life is taking you through. And that's something I didn't necessarily have before. When I was living in New York, it was work, because I love the work I do. It doesn't feel like work. And there wasn't really much time for having a social life. I felt like I wasn't living. The minute I moved there to Yerushalayim, I felt that I had more of that balance. You feel automatically connected to the community, and there was much more of a life there. So I do feel that I grew, but to say that it was a miracle and, you know, I got a call the next day and, you know, somebody asked me to marry them. No, that's not what happened. I did meet somebody shortly after that I thought he was going to be the guy.
Okay.
I did. It was a week after.
Uh-huh. I think I heard you talk about that.
It was right after.
Someone from the United States?
No, not from the United States. There was somebody that I was meeting from the United States, but that didn't work out. But there was somebody.
Someone from Ohio,
yes, exactly.
Right?
Yes, exactly. We went out. It wasn't for us. He actually is married now.
Okay.
But.
So it does work.
It does work,
of course.
It worked
for him.
It worked for him. Fantastic. And then on my end, yeah, I met somebody. It was right on my birthday. I thought it was something that was going to happen. Like, I felt like, wow, this is amazing. This is the person that I was really praying for. But it turns out that it wasn't there. It didn't happen on that regard. We're still very good friends. He's a very close friend of mine.
Maybe you have 100 million people following you, and we only have you know, a few tens of thousands. Maybe we'll be the agency.
I'll be psyched.
So tell us what the profile is. What are you looking for?
It's a good question.
We're going to help you look.
Listen, I'm psyched. If you guys want to help me look, and you guys could do that, if you can be the catalyst, I'd be the happiest person.
You never know where it's going to come from. So
100%, I
tell
believe
us,
so.
What are we
so
looking for?
So what am I looking for? Basically, I'm looking for a person that is kind-hearted, somebody that is generous, very, very important person that has generosity, that is truthful, that's somebody that is trustworthy, that loves kids, because I love kids. Somebody that is ambitious and that is giving. In terms of religion-wise, you know, I grew up in a religious household, very, very spiritual. I wear pants, but I'm like inside of my heart, I'm very, very spiritual. Torah and tefillah are very, very important to me. I'm not saying the person has to be on my same level. I believe in connecting with the person. I believe that everybody grows in their own ways. But somebody that can appreciate that part of me, that spiritual part of me, because I think otherwise it'll be difficult. And, you know, these are some of the basic things. Of course, somebody that I'm attracted to and that would obviously be attracted to me. I think that that's important, sometimes not discussed.
What age range are you looking for in
so
the man?
So I'm 37 years old. I would want to be able to connect with somebody that's around my age. I've gone out with guys that are also a few years younger than me, which is totally fine because I have a very young mindset.
You certainly do, yes.
And I'm very adventurous. Like, I love, you know, adventures, and obviously I love Eretz Yisrael, which is why I'm living there. So those are the things that I'm looking for. I wouldn't pin it like the person has to be this age and has to be that height. So be somebody that, you know, that you want to be able to go through the struggles of life with, go through the highs and also go through the lows, and to be able to be there. Somebody that has that connection of wanting to leave an impact and a legacy in this world. And yeah,
sounds good. So you're a young woman. You're embarking on the next phase of your life. You're going to live in Israel.
Yes,
in a few weeks.
Yes, Bezrat Hashem.
We're recording this on what's today's day? January 28th, I think. So you're going to make it. Are you going through?
I'm going through Nefesh B'Nefesh. Yeah, I'm going through Nefesh B'Nefesh, and hopefully now I'm waiting to just get the final word of the paperwork going through from the Jewish agency. And that's it. And then I'm off. And it's going to be an exciting journey. I was actually thinking, I don't want to say I'm doing it yet because it's a big commitment, but I was going to do a video series of my first 100 days in Israel as an Ola Chadasha.
We have a writer in the Five Towns Jewish Times who made Aliyah 11 years ago.
Okay.
Shmuel Katz. And he did something called Aliyah Chronicle. He started writing a weekly column when his family decided to make Aliyah.
Okay.
And he went through the whole preparatory stage.
Shmuel Katz, the singer?
No, he's not a singer. Shmuel and Katz is, you know, they're two very common Jewish names.
Oh, no, Shlomo Katz, sorry, yes.
Two very common Jewish names.
I meant Shlomo Katz.
Right. No, but Shmuel, he's a friend of ours. He lived here in the Five Towns, and he's been in Eretz Yisrael 11 years now. And his family grew, his kids grew up, and his kids got married. Most of his kids got married, the ones that are of age. And, you know, and he just chronicled in the newspaper on an almost weekly basis.
Really?
The ups and downs of Aliyah.
I love that.
And if you could do a audio-video version of that.
I would love to. That would be awesome.
It could be very inspiring very inspiring to people, or even a weekly column.
100%. That's totally up my alley. I love that kind of stuff.
So, you know, we've had people that try to emulate that or copy it over the years, but it takes a little bit of you have to be able to sustain it. You know?
Of course, I know from doing the 40 days. I know.
You know, a lot of people dream about writing newspaper columns on a regular basis, but when it comes push comes to shove, they
exactly because it's
they
a
can't
commitment.
Get it done because time has a way of just passing by.
That's very true.
Another week and another week goes by. What are you going to be doing professionally once you're in Israel?
So I'm going to continue being working on the organization, but the main thing that I do, I'm a speaker. I'm a public speaker, inspirational speaker. Mm-hmm. I speak in companies and schools and community centers. So that's something that I very, very much love. And I'm going to continue to grow that, running workshops, running talks, running weekends. And so that's a very, very big thing I'm doing. And at the same time, I just recently launched an app called Abraham's Legacy. It's a social network for tefillah. It's all focused on Tehillim. And I did it in memory of my grandfather. So that just recently was launched. And I'm working on getting that out there more to the Jewish world. And increasing the user base. It's a free app. It's meant as a gift to the world. It was a memory of my grandfather. So I'm excited about that.
So what's in these past 10 years since you've been out there and building this image and changing the world of the people that are paying attention to what you're doing, what are some of the most extraordinary things that happened that stand out in your mind that you could share with us?
Wow. There are a lot of stories that I can share. The truth is, and I star so many messages of people that send me, people reach out sharing how the work of the organization has shifted their life, has inspired them to start a new venture of their own. I'll tell you probably one of the most impactful stories. I may have shared it one other time, but I'll share it here with you. This happened when the film went viral. People were reaching out to me, like I mentioned, YouTube was the means of communicating with everybody.
Right.
And if somebody wanted to talk to me, you know, they would say, hey, let's chat, and we'd get onto a Skype call. So I would speak to people from really all over the world. And I got on a phone call one day with this man from Libya. And we started talking about the organization, about the work of the organization, and he started sharing the impact that it's had on him. And then he started tearing, he started crying. He says, you have no idea the change that you've impacted in my life. He said, here in my country, they throw a gun into my hand and they tell me to shoot. He says, I just don't want to shoot anymore. He said to me, you make me believe that I can become something greater than what they tell me I can be. To me, that was a huge revelation of what the power of this can be. There are many people that can potentially be defined by a specific action. Very often when we tell people that they are a specific way, that's exactly who they're going to become. Mm-hmm. But the minute that we open up a world of possibilities by allowing people to dream and to recognize that they actually have a purpose and they matter in this world, it's incredible what we can do.
Well, there are a lot of countries like Libya that are, you know, have a repressive environment. And
they're keeping the people at a
that's
low.
That's right. Absolutely. They want to keep the people dependent.
Exactly.
On, corrupt leadership.
It's unfortunate, yeah.
And unfortunately, a large number of people, maybe even a majority of the world, if you're going to count China, that are living in that kind of repressed kind of society, and they're very, very hungry and thirsty for new thinking.
And then, the minute that they're actually being told that they can, that you can be whatever it is that you want to be, even though they're going to go through lots of struggles, of course, because they're trying to keep them down. You understand? And that's not just within those countries. Even here within in the U.S., we can see differences of mentality in terms of wanting to keep people where they are, and it actually repressing the creative skills, the progress that the world takes, and it's really very hard. So that's why I say empowerment is really the key to so much.
So you're going to set up an office? You're going to work at home?
Yeah, I'm planning to I'm working out of a WeWork there in Jerusalem, which is really great. I am right now in talks. I don't want to mention it yet because it's not official, but I am in talks with another group in terms of getting involved with them and creating a very exciting new, it's a startup program that's beginning. I know I can't talk too much about it, but hopefully within the next week or two, I'll know if that's going to be happening. And if so, I'm going to be working full time on that over these next 3 months. Is going to be a big project that I'm working towards.
Well, Well, you know, Israel's still a very new country, even though it's 70 years old.
Yeah.
And great things are happening there. And I think it's tremendous opportunities for a personality like you, and the energy and the creativity and the innovation that you bring to your work is certainly going to continue to impact, I think, very dramatically.
I appreciate
on that people
very
around
much.
The world, especially in Israel. I really thank you for coming in and talking with us, and we're going to continue to follow you. Now that we've met in person, we're going to continue to follow you, and we're going to try to work on that mission.
That sounds great. Okay? I'm so grateful for the opportunity.
Okay, great. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.